Philadelphia thing. Actually, I call this post-World War II consensus. It's not just the Philadelphia, then you have the UN Charter, then you have the Bretton Woods. All of them coming with the full employment. Recognizing full employment as a government, as a macro, as a policy objective, also defines the role of the government in a modern state. What is the role of the government? It's actually providing full employment. It automatically imposes some conditions. Now, having actually moved away from that with inflation targeting, is basically you also devalue the role of the government because you give that role to the independent, so-called independent. Okay.
Thank you so much. In a sense, my presentation is the logical continuation of the Pascal Petit presentation because I think one of the messages from the previous presentation was that developing countries, because of the ongoing liberalization of trade and of capital flows, developing countries, they face the problem of shrinking policy space. They have less and less tools to, you know, promote economic growth if they choose to proceed with the active industrial policy or active macroeconomic policy promoting growth. Now, one tool that is still available is undervaluation of the exchange rate. And how you achieve undervaluation of the exchange rate? You can do it through accumulation of reserves. You accumulate foreign exchange reserves, you create the excessive demand for foreign currency goes up, and your own currency goes down. Some say this is a self-defeating policy. I'll address the issue in a moment. Actually, it is not. Because under certain conditions, you can accumulate reserves virtually endlessly and underprice your currency. Now, here is some charts just to start the conversation about it. You can see that in many countries, accumulation of reserves, this is Mauritius, goes hand in hand with the growth rates of GDP, GDP per capita growth rates, which is the black curve. And you can see that once reserves are being accumulated, the growth rates of GDP increase, and once reserves accumulation goes down, the growth rates of GDP per capita go down. Of course, there is an issue, where is the chicken, where is the egg? And I'm showing you the good charts. This is Malaysia. There is kind of relationship here. This is Russia. There is kind of relationship in Russia. Russia started, previously Russia didn't have any reserves, but when it started to accumulate reserves, growth rates increased, and then they kind of fluctuated together. Accumulation of reserves and growth rates fluctuated together. So the question is how the mechanism works. Where is the egg? Where is the chicken? Before I come to the question, here is the long-term data for 1699, for 40 years. Growth rates of GDP per capita on the vertical axis, on the horizontal axis, the average ratio of gross international reserves to GDP. Overall, it looks like countries that accumulate reserves grow faster. If you don't believe it, this is the average ratio of gross capital investment to GDP, the accumulation rate, the ratio of investment to GDP. And this is the increase in the ratio of reserves to GDP in percentage points. And it seems like countries that accumulate reserves, they have a higher rate of investment to GDP. Now, this relationship works for developing countries, but not for developed countries. Same chart, average ratio of reserves to GDP for the period of 40 years, and GDP growth rates of GDP per capita. No relationship for developed countries. These are only OECD countries. I can go through the literature review, but basically to make a long story a short one, there was a paper by Danny Roderick in 1986 that developed a model that demonstrated how disequilibrium exchange rate can influence long-term growth. It is not the regular Keynesian effect. In the regular Keynesian effect, depreciation promotes demand, and then we have the increase in output up to the level of potential output. But here we are talking about potential output, how we can increase the rates of growth of potential output. Roderick assumed there is an externality from imports, and he argued that imports is being assisted by the appreciation of exchange rate. So he said overpricing of exchange rate contributes to growth. And he developed a model that you can import machinery, and importing machinery triggers your economic growth. Now, then there were papers that looked, because everyone was looking at East Asia, then there were papers that actually looked at the underpricing of the exchange rate, and they argued that if you underprice your exchange rate, and of course especially it is true about countries which are resource rich and which have or which face the danger of developing Dutch disease from the export, from the excess revenues from export of resources. So there are papers that argue that it's better to underprice exchange rate than to overprice exchange rate. And there is the paper where I was a co-author. This is a paper which was written about 10 years ago, and the paper argues that if you underprice the exchange rate, there is a model, a mathematical model, and there is also empirics, there are regressions. And the paper argues if you underprice the exchange rate, then you actually promote economic growth. The paper was never published. It's interesting enough. That's why I'm presenting this paper. But this paper has more citations than published papers. Yes, I have a lot of published papers, but this paper has more citations. So this paper actually got quite an attention. Now, this is just one of the recent papers. I just selected it to show the typical one. This is a good paper because it refers to our paper, but this is not such a good paper because it develops a measure of underpricing of exchange rate like most of the other papers. They developed a measure looking at the equilibrium exchange rate. And the equilibrium exchange rate, there are different ways to calculate the equilibrium exchange rate. For instance, you can use this Balassa-Samuelson effect story, and you can see that for poorer countries, the real exchange rate is underpriced, and you can see the normal relationship of the ratio of prices in the developing country to the prices in developed country, depending on the GDP per capita. You can have the normal regression, and you can see what is the deviation from regression line. And then you can calculate overvaluation or undervaluation of the exchange rate. Now, our argument is this is not a good measure. Currencies may be overpriced or underpriced, depending on many particular conditions, and maybe objective conditions. Maybe there is a war in the country, so capital flees, so the currency falls to a very low level. Or maybe there is a Dutch disease, the country, the currency gets overpriced, and so on. So what we try to measure is the policy-induced undervaluation of the currency. Before coming to this measure of policy-induced undervaluation of the currency, so why currency is underpriced? Because of policy reasons, not because of objective reasons, but because of policy reasons. Before I come to that, let me talk about one of the reservations. The reservation about this approach that you're supposed to accumulate reserves to grow faster is that this is a self-defeating policy. When you accumulate reserves, you increase your money supply. When you increase your money supply, you have to sterilize the increases in money supply, otherwise you have inflation. So you sterilize the increases in money supply, you increase your interest rate. Your interest rate increases, there is a capital inflow in the country. So you have to sterilize even more, you increase your interest rate even more. So this is a self-defeating policy. You cannot proceed with this policy. Well, this is not exactly the case. This is the balance of the central bank and the balance of payments. This shows how it works. You, if there is an increase in reserves, reserve accumulation, yes, increases. Then there is an increase in money supply which is needed to be sterilized. The increase in reserves leads to increase in the money supply. Then it needs to be sterilized through issue of bonds. Then there is an increase in the interest rate. And then there is an inflow of capital which needs to be sterilized. But neither theoretically nor empirically, this relationship does not work. First, if you see the regular identities, the increase in money supply, this is the central bank identity, the balance of the central bank identity. The increase in money supply is equal to increase in forex and increase in the bonds, government bonds that are held by the central bank. The budget deficit can be financed by selling bonds to the central bank or by selling bonds to the public. So the increase in foreign exchange reserves can be financed by increasing the money supply, by increasing the budget surplus, and by increase in the bonds sent to the public. Now, if there is an increase in money supply, you can sterilize it, and if you don't have capital, free capital flows, you can sterilize it endlessly. And if you look at the actual numbers, you can look what is the increase these are all the measures of the reserve accumulation, and you can see whether this reserve accumulation is linked to government budget surplus, to government budget debt, to annual inflation, and you can see that the relationship with the annual inflation is insignificant. Countries that accumulate reserves do not stimulate inflation because these coefficients are insignificant. But they have greater government debt, those countries that accumulate reserves, and they have greater budget surpluses. So that's how they accumulate reserves. That's how the reserve accumulation is proceeding. And besides, there is a huge increase in monetization. If you look at China, there is a huge increase in monetization of the economy. So you accumulate reserves, you increase the money supply, but there is an increase in monetization in the ratio of money supply to GDP at current prices, and so there is no inflation. Yes, the GDP grows, but inflation doesn't grow. The ratio of the money supply to GDP increases. Now, how the foreign exchange reserves accumulation influences growth? As I said, it's not a regular Keynesian effect. It is the effect that mostly runs through the impact on exports. If you accumulate reserves, you are drawing the country into export-oriented development. You underprice your exchange rate, and when you underprice your exchange rate, you increase the ratio of export to GDP and the ratio of trade to GDP because you can import, right? If your export grows, you can also import. And then this increases your growth rates. In the model, we assume externality from exports. But, you know, this is the very easy thing. This is a very weak assumption because definitely there is an externality from exports. Many papers show it, and especially from high-tech exports. Danny Roderick has a lot of papers saying that from high-tech exports, and the more exports is high-tech, the greater is the externality. Now, the technique is this one. First, we separate the accumulation of reserves, the increase in reserves, into two components. First is called objective accumulation of reserves, or the accumulation of reserves that is driven by objective needs. What are the needs? Well, if you trade more, you need more reserves to dampen all the trade shocks. Or if your capital flows are large, then you need more reserves. Or if your debt is large, you need more reserves to service the debt, right? So we look at all these variables. The best equation we have is that reserve accumulation depends on GDP per capita, on trade to GDP ratio, and on the variability of trade to GDP. I think this is called delta, but this is not delta. This is sigma, actually. This is the standard deviation of the ratio of trade to GDP, how it varies. And then we, after running this regression, we see what is the residual. And the residual from this regression, the accumulation of reserves that is not fitting, that is not explained by this variable, is called policy-induced accumulation of reserves. And then we introduce this variable, policy-induced change in foreign exchange reserves, as one of the explanatory variables into regular growth regressions, and we get the results, we get many results, but one of the best results and simplest results is this one. You control for a number of variables, for all the usual variables. You control for population growth rates, sometimes investment because the effects go through investment and sometimes not through investment. And the size of the country and the level of development, of course, so everything is controlled for. And then you have the accumulation of reserves multiplied by brackets. There is an interaction term, accumulation of reserves multiplied by GDP per capita. So once you reorganize it in such a way as you have the brackets, you have the threshold of about 67%, which means that if your GDP per capita in 1975 was below 67% of the level of the United States, then your accumulation of reserves was spurring economic growth. But if your GDP per capita was above 67% of the US level, then the accumulation of reserves had a negative impact on economic growth. Now, if you want some other charts, this is the increase in the ratio of foreign exchange reserves to GDP, and this is the real exchange rate, the ratio of domestic prices to American prices. And you can see that there is a relationship. We check every chain, every mechanism, every chain in the relationship. So we check whether the accumulation of reserves leads to underpricing of the exchange rate. We check if the underpricing of the exchange rate leads to greater investment. And of course, greater investment lead to greater GDP. And we classify all the countries into the fast-growing countries. We take fast-growing countries and we bring them to the point of zero, which is the time when the takeoff turns place. The takeoff is the start of the rapid growth. The rapid growth is the moment when your growth rates increase 3.5% of GDP and remain at this level for about 20 years or more. And then this is the takeoff. Yes, so for different countries, the year of takeoff is different, but we bring all the countries to the same year. And this is the story we get. This black line is the reserve to GDP ratio. It grows, and the growth rates, the blue line, starts to increase. Then it kind of, you know, stops accumulation of reserves, and growth rates go down. And then in 15 years from the takeoff year, the growth, there is another accumulation of reserves, and the growth rates start to increase again. Now, excuse me, there is also a mechanism. When you accumulate the reserves, you underprice your exchange rate, and there is also a mechanism to attract foreign direct investment. And why it happens? Because your assets are cheap. If you underprice your exchange rate, your assets become cheap. So this mechanism is also at work, but this is not such an important mechanism. So this is the chart which shows the effect which was just discussed by Luis Carlos Bezos Pereira. Countries that grow fast, they do not borrow abroad. They give credits to the other countries. The example is China. China saves more than it invests, and the extra savings are being invested through the investment of reserves into US Treasury bills. China finances with its savings the American savings, American investment and American consumption. And yes, this is counterintuitive, as Luis Carlos Bezos Pereira just discussed. You would think that poor countries should attract capital, and then they can grow. But the, in fact, what we have is all economic miracles are based on domestic savings. Even more so, not only those countries mobilize their own domestic savings, they were exporting their savings abroad. In a sense, China made the United States a proposal that was difficult to refuse. China said, we're going to finance your current account deficit. You're going to be able to consume 3% more than you are producing. You know, 3% is a lot, right? If you think about it, it's billions, billions, hundreds of billions of dollars. But in exchange, we want the access to the market. So the access to the market spurred Chinese growth, and China had to lose 3%, 2-3% of GDP every year, just putting these 2-3% into reserves. So China was consuming less than it was producing. So you lose in today, but this is for the sake of long-term growth. And there is, of course, the question, if all the countries pursue this policy, then, 1 minute, thank you, if all the countries pursue this policy, then everyone would lose. But the answer to the question is that developing countries have the right to develop. And because they have the right to develop, yes, they are supposed, for the whole world, it would be better if they would use this policy. And because I have 1 minute only, I will mention only that countries that are currently developed previously were using the same policy. You wouldn't believe it, maybe, or maybe you don't remember. I know you cannot see much in this table, but I'll tell you what is there. This is the American balance of payments. This is the American trade balance, excuse me. Exports, excess of exports, plus or minus, over imports, since 1790, for every year since 1790. So basically, just take my word for it. From the period of the Civil War, just a little bit after the Civil War, in 1873-4, the American trade balance became positive and continued to be positive for 100 years, until 1970s, from 1870s to 1970s. And the same is true for most developed countries. If you see the, say, countries like United States, this is the net international investment position, debt, net debt. Previously, United States was net creditor, now it's a net debtor. But net debt is something like 20% of GDP only. If you see the Japan is a net creditor. If you see European Union as a whole, Euro area investment position is 10%. It sounds like 10% of GDP only, 10% of GDP minus, which is a very small debt. And if you see the debt by countries, net debt by countries, you know, net, these are net assets. So most countries, developed countries, have net assets, so they're net creditors. Some countries are net debtors, but only several countries, like United States. This should be, sorry, you don't look here. This is $1 billion. You look here, this is the interest rates, because I thought it's a mistake. But only countries like Spain and Australia, and that's about it, have significant net indebtedness. The other countries don't have this net indebtedness, and there is a room to go into debt. So because there is a room to go into debt, this is what is supposed to happen. And when developing countries become developed, then there would be a balance, right? There would be no reason to go into that. Now, these are immortal works that spell the argument in a greater detail. Thank you so much.